Hey guys, this is AC Service Tech, and today what we're looking at is the pressure testing of a comfort cooling air conditioning system, as well as an oil blowout procedure. Okay, so anytime that you're brazing refrigerant lines onto part of an existing system, so say you're replacing the evap coil, all right, the indoor coil, after you're done brazing and after you're done pressure testing, which I'm going to show you here, you want to go ahead and do an oil blowout, because if you don't do that, there could be oil that's stuck in the 3/8 tubing. You're going to see that when you run your micron gauge, it's going to go back and forth, back and forth. You might think that you're running a good vacuum and you'll be down at, say, 800 microns, but it'll jump back and forth between maybe 600 microns and 800, 600 and 800, or something along that nature. Basically, as you run your vacuum pump, your micron level should steadily go down and should not be jumping up and down any more than maybe, say, 10 microns or something like that. It should not be jumping around 150 to 300 microns, because what that means is you have like a little glob of oil traveling back and forth in the evaporator or some other spot. Okay, so you need to be able to do an oil blowout procedure. So we're going to go ahead and get started. We're going to pressure test this air conditioning system. I'm asked how high of a pressure should you put in this worth of nitrogen in order to pressure test it. And the answer can be found on the indoor coil. All right, so this is the indoor evaporator coil, and this one says max design pressure 450 PSIG. If you do not see a existing max pressure on your evap coil, and it's you notice that it's older, you may only want to pressure test that up to, say, 125 PSIG, because I have seen rating plates on evaporator coils that are older with a design pressure max of about 150. All right, so you want to stay a little lower than that, just if you don't see that the rating plate is available. Okay, so you don't want to make leaks in the evap coil. That's basically what I want to tell you. You should not be pressure testing an old evap coil up to 400, 500 PSIG, because they were never meant to handle that pressure. Okay, so here we go. All right, so we're going to go ahead and turn the nitrogen on. We have our first stage gauge and our second stage, and then we have our thumb regulator screw. Okay, this right here, if you back it out all the way, it's going to end up falling out. So you don't want to have it out all the way, but you don't want to have it down inwards, because it's going to allow pressure into your secondary gauge. So we're going to go ahead and have that loose. We're going to go ahead and turn on the nitrogen, and we're reading about 600 PSIG, and we're going to go ahead and turn this screw downwards until the pressure starts to increase, allowing it through the regulator. So we're going to turn it up to about 200 PSIG, which is on this particular gauge, it's on the inside ring right there. And then we're going to allow it into our manifold set, okay, through this hose. And then we're going to allow it to go into the refrigerant lines. So we're letting it in one side, it's actually making it through to the other side, and the other side is going up as well. And let's put it right at about 200 PSIG. All right, we're at about 200 PSIG on both gauges, and that's because we're only allowing about 200 here. So now we're going to go ahead and let this sit. You want to use maybe some micron leak detector right here, like a super blue. This is I use this a lot, so I end up spraying that on the joints, any joints that I brazed, and then I'll let that pressure test sit. Obviously, the longer you let it sit, the better. Just one tip for you, that if you take this tank out of a warmer truck and you're putting the pressure into the lines, but it's cold outside, whatever pressure you put in there, it's going to look maybe like a leak, because the pressure will end up reducing, okay? Because it was expanded, meaning hot, and then now it's in cool lines because it's outside. Okay, so but once that nitrogen pressure stabilizes, you can go ahead and let it sit there. And like I said, the longer the better. But you're on a service call, you let it sit at least 15 minutes, and you spray down all of your joints with your bubble leak detector. I use this super blue. I really like that stuff. But other ones will work as well. But any of your joints that you braise, go ahead and spray them down. Any of the orifice chambers or TXV spots, maybe any flares if there is any. Go ahead and spray all that stuff down. I usually tend to spray it down just so I don't waste time sitting here waiting for the pressure test just to see if it ends up
So
dropping.
now we're going to go ahead and let our nitrogen out, and I'm just going to go ahead and shut this port right here, and I'm just going to let the nitrogen out right through the high side line. All right, so now what we're going to do is we're going to do the oil blowout procedure. So we have to actually run nitrogen in through here, and we're going to be pulling the Schrader valve or the valve core out, whatever you'd like to call it, and then we're going to put an oil catch right here in case any oil comes out. So we're going to take that red line off and just put it immediately onto the holder, basically for the hose, so that it doesn't fall onto the concrete and end up getting any dirt in the lines. That's very important. Now you can take your valve core removal tool. You just use a valve core wrench as well. I just happen to have this out, so I might as well just go ahead and use this one. Right, so there's our valve core or Schrader valve. Make sure you put that in the area where it doesn't pick up any other dirt. All right. So now we're going to go ahead and put our can in place as our oil catch. And we're going to allow our nitrogen back in, and we're going to flow it through the low side. So you want to get that pressure up to about 150 or so. Let it flow in there real good. All right, and no oil in the can, but what happened there is it blew any oil along the walls of the pipe. This way I can get a good vacuum through the walls of the pipe. All right, so if you're going to end up having refrigerant oil in those lines, regardless of how much you flow nitrogen through or whatever, you just want to make sure that the little that's in there that you can't get out is blown along the walls of the pipe so that you can run a proper vacuum. If you do an oil blowout the day before and then you're planning on doing a vacuum the next day, you're going to end up having to do the oil blowout again because the oil has then been able to drip down and basically become a glob basically in the inside of the liquid line again, and you're not going to get a clean vacuum through. So you got to do the oil blowout right before you run the vacuum pump. Now we're going to go ahead and shut the nitrogen down. We're going to go ahead and shut the tank down first, shut the manifold, and then we're going to open up our service line, let whatever nitrogen out, and then we're going to back out the thumb screw. Okay. Alrighty. So at this stage, what we're going to do is we're going to end up running the vacuum pump. All right, we can either put this valve core back in, or we can end up attaching our valve core removal tool onto there without the Schrader valve in it, and we can end up pulling from this line right here, as well as this one. But for this instance, I'm just going to go ahead and put this valve core back in, and we'll get our vacuum pump set up. All right, these Schrader valves are in here and here. You can leave them out if you have a valve core removal tool on each of these right here. But I chose to just go ahead and leave them in this time. We have our micron gauge hooked up to our service port. And what you want to make sure of is that there is absolutely no pressure on this manifold before you go ahead and hook up your micron gauge. So I'm going to go ahead and just make sure that these are slightly open, that there's definitely no pressure. And I'm going to go ahead and open these up. Okay, you saw a little pressure shoot out. I want to make sure that I do not open the port going to the micron gauge until I definitely know for sure there is no pressure. You just want to take care of these things because if a micron gauge is starting to act funny, it could be a real pain, okay? But you have to troubleshoot it, try to figure out if that is the problem or if it's something else like a leak in the hose or a leak in the line or whatever. So anyway, right now these are a little loose and that's the way I like to leave it. I'm going to go ahead and open this one up right here. I'm going to go ahead and also open up our vacuum port, and I'm going to go ahead and turn on the vacuum pump here. It's going to suck in through here, and it's attached to both riptide, and the micron gauge. These two are a little loose. That's the way I like to do it when I start the vacuum pump up, and then I go ahead and close those down. All right, so that's how it's done. You want to go ahead and pull your micron down below 500 microns. It's best to get it 300-400 microns, and then you can trap your vacuum by shutting off this port and then turning off your vacuum pump. All right, hope you enjoyed yourself. We'll see you next time at AEC Service Tech Channel.